2. All right. Well, let me go ahead and say good evening to everyone. I'm very thankful for another opportunity for us to come together as we will once again study the Word of God, but we're studying the Word with a very interesting interest. And that is that we're looking at not simply the gospel, but we're looking at the gospel of health. And I believe if any of you were with us last night, you would understand the great grand relevance of the gospel of health. And that is what the world needs right now. And so it is that tonight and onward, we're going to be even more specific in our presentations, because now we're not just simply going to talk generally about the gospel of health, but we're going to look at how the gospel of health can meet the various needs and even the diseases of humanity. And so tonight we're going to be talking about that silent killer, which is none other than hypertension. And I believe that God is going to make some powerful things plain to our hearts to help us understand what this disease is, what are its causes, what are the means to prevent it, and even by the grace of God, how it can be overcome. And before we do any step or take any step in our study for this evening, I believe the best way to begin is with a word of prayer. And so I'm going to go to my knees, and if you would like to, and if you're able to, I'll invite you to kneel with me. But if you cannot kneel, just bow your heads where you are. But let's all pray together as we prepare our hearts to receive this evening's blessing. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful that we have an opportunity to become intelligent in regard to disease, its causes, prevention, and even its cures. But Lord, we acknowledge your word, and you have shown us last night that it is only the Lord our God that heals. And this is the reason why we come to you, asking you first for the forgiveness of our sins, and then also for the cleansing power of your Holy Spirit, and that he would come and that he would minister to our hearts and truly open our eyes and help us behold beautiful things out of your word. I ask you to make your words plain to us tonight. I pray that you will help anyone who is afflicted with this disease to see a key that can unlock heaven's storehouse of healing by which, by your grace, we can overcome. Make your words plain to us tonight, we pray. And I thank you that you have heard this prayer, and I also thank you that you will answer it, for we believe this is according to your will. Therefore, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe one of the first things that we want to do, just to make sure that we have an understanding, is you're going to find that I have just a couple of video clips, and I'm going to play one of them right now. And the purpose of the video clip is they're very short, and the goal is just to simply give us an understanding of the very topic we're studying tonight, which is none other than hypertension. So let's go ahead, let's take a look at the video clip, and then afterwards I will come back and we will continue to progress in our study for this evening. So let's notice the video clip. Try that one more time. There we are.
Do you know if you have high blood pressure? Find out how you can prevent or control it. High blood pressure, when left untreated, can damage the blood vessels in your body. It hardens the arteries as cholesterol and calcium builds up. Over time, the arteries narrow, restricting blood flow and damaging critical organs like the heart, brain, eyes, and kidneys. The first sign of high blood pressure affecting the heart is the thickening of the heart muscle. It now struggles to pump blood into the circulatory system through narrowing arteries. Left untreated, the condition worsens, and all this time, you do not feel any symptoms. Over time, high blood pressure further narrows the arteries, cutting off blood to the heart. When your arteries become critically narrow, or if a piece of the blockage breaks off, it may result in a heart attack. A heart attack can cause permanent damage to the heart muscle by affecting its ability to pump blood, resulting in heart failure. high blood pressure is a leading cause of kidney failure. Damaged blood vessels in your kidney affect its ability to filter and clean blood. Left untreated, the kidney will eventually fail and dialysis or a kidney transplant will be needed. In your eyes, high blood pressure can affect the tiny arteries of the retina. Bleeding and blockage can result in blurred or lost vision. When arteries harden in the brain, you can suffer a stroke that damages brain tissue. Some arteries may rupture, causing bleeding or hemorrhage. This can result in slurred speech, paralysis, and loss of consciousness. Do you know if you have high blood pressure? Find out how you can prevent or control it. Eat healthy, relax, lose weight, and take all medication given by your doctor, and you can control high blood pressure and stay healthy. Talk to your Kaiser Permanente healthcare professional today to learn more.
Now, one of the things I think is very interesting about the video is that it actually talks about controlling the disease. And of course, it gives you that very simple regimen, you know, eat a good diet, exercise, of course, take those prescriptions, and follow the instructions of your doctor. And I want to make it clear from the beginning, I am not here as one who is quote unquote against the idea of physicians, nurses, doctors, etc. I believe every physician, every nurse and doctor, they have their place and they have their relevance, okay? I want to make that very clear. But I also believe that there sometimes can be missing keys, missing points in relation to the function of many of our physicians, doctors, nurses, and etc. And it's for these reasons that God wants to give us a reminder of not how the gospel only ministers to the soul, but also can minister to the body. And that's why we have the gospel of health. Now, as we get ready to go through this, one of the things we're going to see is not so much how we can control, but by God's grace, if you have hypertension, how it can be overcome. Today, this is a disease that is still often known or recognized as something that is incurable. There is no cure, and many times they even say there is no cause. Well, I believe that the Word of God has something different to show us tonight, and even true science. And so the first thing we're going to do is just talk about what is blood pressure generally. When you think of blood pressure from a general standpoint, your heart, my heart, it pumps approximately 1,900 gallons of blood through the blood vessels in your body every single day. That is a ton of blood. And then it goes on, blood pressure is the force applied against the walls of the arteries as the heart pumps blood through the body. The pressure is determined by the force and amount of blood pumped and the size and flexibility of the arteries. So that's your general concept of what blood pressure is. Now, once we understand that, then obviously the next question is, well, then what is high blood pressure? And high blood pressure basically is this. Forgive me. High blood pressure, when we look back at it, I'm just going to go back a slide here. What is high blood pressure? It's when it's difficult for the blood to flow through the blood vessels and the pressure against the walls of your vessels will increase. And this can cause high blood pressure, also known as hypertension. How many of you are familiar with the creature called the boa constrictor? Are we familiar with that? Now, does the boa constrictor kill its prey by venom? No, it does not. It kills its prey by doing what? Squeezing it, constricting it. So when you generally think of high blood pressure, you're thinking about those blood vessels, but what's happening is those blood vessels are going through what we would call vasoconstriction. There's a constricting of the vessels, and as a result of that, because of the narrowing, there is now going to have to be more pressure applied by the heart to get the blood through. There's something that's narrowing those arteries that causes the heart to go ahead and have to put more pressure. Now, this is where we get, again, the concept of vasoconstriction. But what we want is more so vasodilation. I see many of us wearing glasses. And one of the things that is for sure is that before you get your prescription for your glasses, you first have to have your eyes what? Dilated. And when you have your eyes dilated, is it closed or is it open? It's open. So what we want is we want to go from vasoconstriction to vasodilation. We want to get those blood vessels where they're nice and open, that the blood can flow right through and the heart does not have to apply undue pressure. Well, one of the things then we have to consider is, what are the proper numbers for this? There is something called the systolic and diastolic numbers, and I'm just going to use my little medical books here. You know, I had the privilege of being trained in medical missionary work from professional doctors and nurses and et cetera. And I'm very thankful for that training. It was a blessing. But at the same time, I am still not a medical professional. So one of the first questions that anyone would have to ask themselves is, why in the world would they listen to an ignorant fisherman like me when it comes to the concepts of health? And the reason why I would recommend that you do listen is because though I am a minister and called of God to give his gospel, all at the same time, I am thankful that I understand the gospel of health from his word, but also I like to quote physicians. I like to quote physicians that have gone ahead and done the work. They've done the homework. They have decided to not just look at disease from a symptomatic standpoint, but they want to look at it from a cause to effect standpoint and look at it from the perspective of lifestyle. And I appreciate that. So this is one of my little handy books here, and it's a simple book. I call it the easy read. It is one of the most layman's way of understanding a lot of things in the medical world as it relates to disease, its causes, prevention, and cure. This is a book that is entitled Health Power, and Health Power is an accessible book. You can get it from your book and Bible houses, and it is put together by medical professionals, and it really does help us understand these diseases, and of course, by God's grace, how to overcome it. So when I go to page 40, just to understand a little bit about blood pressure, it says right here in page 41, it kind of goes through a little chart, and it just helps you understand what is the goal. The goal is simply this. There is something that we call high blood pressure, then there's something called high normal blood pressure, and then there's something called optimal blood pressure. Now, if you had an option between optimal, high normal, or just straight up high blood pressure, which one would you want? Well, you want optimal. So let me go ahead and start with optimal. Optimal is when your systolic number is below 120 and your diastolic number is below 80. So if somebody, let's say, was something along the lines of a 116 over 75, that's what you would call optimal blood pressure. But then there's something that is called high normal blood pressure, which means it is kind of high, but it's also pretty normal because most people are sick. And you know, and I don't like these type of statistics, quite honestly. It's like the world is so used to sick people that, you know, even when you are abnormal, the abnormal has now become the normal. You understand that? I remember one time, quick little story. I remember one time I went to get my checkup. And I do believe in checkups, okay? And I remember I went to the doctor and I went to get my checkup. So they did all my blood work and everything. When they did my blood work, I remember they said, okay, in about a couple of days, we're gonna go ahead and give you your numbers, let you know how you're doing. So a few days went by and I did not get a phone call. So obviously I'm getting a little concerned, so I wanna find out what's going on. So I decided to call the office. My doctor's name was Trivedi, Dr. Trivedi. And I remember that I called Dr. Trivedi's office and I said, hello, my name is Dwayne Lemon. I was getting my blood work done and I need to understand what happened with my results because no one called me. And the young lady said, wait a minute, you're Dwayne Lemon? I said, yes, I am. And her next response was this. She said, Dr. Trivedi really needs to talk to you. Now, when you're calling to find out what's going on with you and your body, and when the secretary says to you, the doctor really needs to talk to you, are you thinking negative or positive? You're thinking negative. That's human nature. So obviously, I'm getting a little antsy. I'm like, really? What's wrong? Well, she said, well, the doctor's a little busy, but she'll call you later. I said, well, listen, I'm going to do better than that. I'm jumping in my car, and I'm coming down. So I decided to go down there, and I went to the office, and I went up to the secretary, and I said, hello, my name is Dwayne Lemon. And then she looked at me, and she said, the doctor really needs to talk to you. So now I'm really, you know, heart starting to palpitate a little bit, you know, I mean, I'm starting to get a little skipping of the beat going on, and I'm really wanting to know what's going on. Well, the doctor finally comes. She says, Mr. Lemon, please come to the back. Come. I said, all right, I'm coming, and then I went, and I sat down. She said, please, have a seat. And when doctors tell you have a seat, that just makes it even more, you know, now I'm getting more anxious. Why I gotta sit down? Why can't you tell me why can't I stand up? You know? So I'm sitting down and I'm waiting to hear what's wrong with me. And she says, Mr. Lemon, we have gone over your blood work. We have looked at you. We checked your pressure. We checked everything. She said, Mr. Lemon, there is not one thing that we need to tell you that you need to improve upon. According to our records and according to our tests, you have a perfect, clean bill of health. I needed to talk to you because I wanted to know, what are you doing? That's why Dr. Trivedi wanted to talk to me. And I said, well, since you put it like that, now I'm calm. And now I'm very happy. And now I'm ready to have a great conversation. The world is not used to individuals that have perfect, faultless, overcoming health like we talked about last night. The world is always used to going ahead and seeing and telling us something that's wrong with us. And so it is, it's almost sad that there's a such thing as high normal blood pressure. Because that's how many people just are not living in the optimal. Are you following? But we recognized last night that we are the children of God, and God wants for us the best. I want you to remember this. Even better can become the greatest enemy of best. Our goal is never to be better. Our goal is not simply to do better. Our goal is to be the best of everything God called us to be. And I wonder how many of you remember the reason why. The reason why God calls us to be the best, to do our best, and to give him our best is because he says, whatever I require of you, I will be your strength and power source to make sure you get it done. That's why God wants the best from us. And so it is, if you find that you're in this high normal blood pressure, the goal is not to stay there. The goal is not to gloat and say, well, I'm doing better than others. The goal is, Lord, show me how through following your counsels, I can get to the place that I have optimal blood pressure. Do we understand? Very good. So, high normal blood pressure, what is that? Well, high normal blood pressure is when your systolic number is 120 to 129 or 80 to 84. So if you're anywhere between 120 to 129 over 80 or 84, that is recognized as high normal blood pressure. And then obviously, if you want to know what high blood pressure is, that is obviously 130 systolic and above, over 85 diastolic and above. So we want to make sure that as far as goal setting is concerned, our goal is to be under that 120 and under that 80, just slightly under those numbers, and then we can know we have now entered into the world of optimal blood pressure. And the truth of the matter is that most people don't have this, but a lot of the world, in fact, has the opposite. And as a matter of fact, if you were to think about it, if we were to ask ourselves the question, well, who is it really that has high blood pressure? How many people? Look at this alarming statistic. About 70 million Americans, and all the statistics that I'm showing you come from the Center of Disease Control's actual website and their data. So this is where it's coming from. So everything you'll see on the screen is coming from the Center of Disease Control, coming from the Mayo Clinic. I mean, very, very reputable organizations, up to date of the latest of the latest. And this is it. About 70 million American adults, which makes up 29%, have high blood pressure, and that's in fact one of every three adults. That's how serious it is. And we're not talking about high blood pressure in the context of, you go outside and a car screeches past you and you get scared and your blood pressure goes up. That doesn't mean you have high blood pressure. It's not talking about when you go to the gym and then you go ahead and get a workout. It's not talking about when somebody comes and scares you. We're talking about when your blood pressure is consistently that 130 over 85 and up, and it's constantly like that, especially over a 48-hour period. Once you get about to a 48-hour period and you're noticing my blood pressure keeps staying like this, whether I'm excited or not, that becomes an indicator, okay, I am hypertensive. I am one of those three. So this is a very alarming number when we look at the statistics. Then, high blood pressure costs the nation $46 billion each year. $46 billion each year. This total includes the cost of healthcare services, medications to treat high blood pressure, and missed days of work. So that is an alarming number that's going just towards dealing with hypertension as well as the actual individuals who suffer with it. Now, when we think about our brothers and our sisters, especially from the quote-unquote African-American or black community, the statistics are even more alarming. African-Americans have it over a third more often than Caucasians, and those 18 to 44 years old of age have it more frequently than Caucasians. So when we start looking at a lot of our quote-unquote black or African-American communities, there's a massive infliction of this disease as well. But even not, and it's not just simply black, quote unquote, or white, but it's also women. There are statistics that are coming up consistently even about our sisters, and notice what it says here. Women are about as likely as men to develop high blood pressure during their lifetimes. However, for people younger than 45 years old, the condition affects more men than women. But notice this now. For people 65 years old or older, high blood pressure affects more women than men. So once you get approximately 65 or older, you find more women being diagnosed with hypertension than you find men being diagnosed. We need to talk about that. Then also, watch this, women have hypertension less often than men until menopause is over. So that's one of the indicators of why once they get approximately 65 years of age and above, we start finding that the women start even overwhelming the men, because we know that menopause obviously starts kicking in around this time frame. And therefore it shows soon after they have it as often and as men. Once menopause, they start having it as often as men. Not only that, but children. And this becomes pretty alarming. So this is not just black, white, Filipino, or otherwise. This is not just male or female, but it's also children. Notice, NBC News, they found an amazing study. Salty snacks, extra pounds send blood pressure soaring in U.S. kids. Notice the quotation here. Spurred by too much salt and too many extra pounds, blood pressure in America's kids and teens has gone sky high, creating a young generation at risk for serious health problems, including heart disease, stroke, and worse, which is typically death. So we can't even exempt our youth. And I'll tell you one of the reasons why. There was a time when young people went outside to play. Notice I'm speaking in past tense language. There was a time that young people would go outside and they would spend time in nature. And they would go ahead and enjoy themselves outside. Well, one of our issues is that we lack a lot of nature. We're surrounded by a lot of bricks and mortar. But then in addition to that, we also find that young people, they have become a gadget crazy generation. And therefore, there's always something in their hands that they're pressing play and rewind and watching and so on. And a lot of times they're sitting down rather than going outside and working their bodies, riding the bikes, rollerblading, running and playing, freeze tag, etc. It almost seems like that generation of youth are almost extinct. So the more that young people get lazy and sit home and watch a lot of TV and play video games and do all these other things, no wonder we're finding that they're gaining extra pounds and their blood pressure is going sky high. In fact, look at the ages. Watch this one. When you look at the ages, it says the percentage of American children and adolescents ages 8 to 17. It says who have high blood pressure, a risk factor for cardiovascular disease, organ damage, heart attacks, and stroke, climbed 27% over 13 years, according to researchers from Harvard Medical School, Brigham and Women's Hospital, and other institutions funded by the National Institutes of Health. That is absolutely alarming. And so one of the first things that I would recommend, especially to those of us that are parents, let us do all that we can ever to put forth the diligent effort to keep our children outside of the house at appropriate times in good recreation, better known as recreation. Let them go ahead and spend that time on the bikes, spend that time on the rollerblades, spend that time climbing up the trees. Let them do things that exert good energy and vital force so that way their bodies can get the best strength and health they need. All of this sitting around in the house and in the home and constantly having gadgets in their hand is literally slowly but surely killing our children. So it's something we really have to pay attention to, okay? Well, continuing. Some other things that we need to understand is this. So, you know, when we think about hypertension, remember, we had to go ahead and address a very powerful biblical principle. We learned last night that whenever someone is stricken with a disease or some type of sickness, what was the first step that the Word of God taught us that we should do? It was to do what? Ascertain the cause. Remember that? We looked at the Bible. Remember, what is the cause? We looked at Proverbs 26 in verse 2, which says, the curse causeless shall not come. Remember that? A curse never comes without a cause. We studied that last night. Then we remembered also from Job that Job had an attitude which was, the cause which I knew not, I searched out. So the goal of God is that whenever there is a disease present in our system, we must do all that we can to understand a disease never comes without a cause. And the cause that we don't know, don't sit down about it. Get up and search it out. Remember that? Now, the reason why this is important is because I showed you last night the curse causeless. And I would imagine some of you are probably saying, wait a minute. Last night you did say a curse never comes without a cause, but then you surmise that it means a disease never comes without a cause. How do you connect a curse with a disease? Well, it's very simple. In the Bible, especially Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, there was what was called the Egyptian diseases. And in Deuteronomy 28, it's the chapter literally of blessings and curses. When you study Deuteronomy 28, it's a chapter of blessings and curses. Verses 1 to 14 are the blessings. Verses 15 to approximately 63 are the curses. A lot of curses. And so it is that you'll remember last night we looked at Exodus 15. Now, let's turn back there. I want us to go there before we go through this. Let's look again at Exodus, the 15th chapter. And just when you get there, do me a favor. Let me know by saying amen. Exodus, the 15th chapter. And I want you to watch what the Bible says. And this is beautiful lessons because most times people look at the Bible as a spiritual book, but very few times do people look at the Bible as a health book. And we need to understand that the Bible contains the gospel of health, so it's not just a book to our spiritual well-being, it is a book to our physical well-being. Well, in Exodus 15 and verse 26, let's look at something God says as it related to disease. The Bible says in Exodus 15, 26, "And he said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee." I want you to think about that. God says, I will put how many? He says, I'll put none. Now, either God's telling the truth or he's lying. And I believe he's telling the truth. So anytime we do not see a promise of God realized, there's no point in looking up to heaven. We need to look in the mirror. Because God does not fail ever on a single promise. But it is possible that the one that we behold in the mirror could break the promise. Remember, promises are based on conditions. Did you catch that in the verse? God says, if you do, if you hearken, if you keep, if you follow, then you'll get. So God can make beautiful promises in his word, but just remember, the realization of the promise is based on us following the condition. If we don't meet the condition and yet claim the promise, that's called presumption. If we hear God promise, but we will not comply with the conditions, yet will claim the promise anyhow, that is not faith, that is presumption. Faith is when we cooperate with God's promise, comply with the conditions, and have full expectation he will do what he said. And so it is that God makes it clear. He says, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon thee, Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. Now, when you study Deuteronomy 28, you will literally study those curses that fell on the Egyptians, but watch how these curses were in fact diseases. So notice, in verse 22, there was something called the consumption. And in medical terms, even today, we know that consumption is what? Tuberculosis. So notice, the consumption was tuberculosis and emphysema. That was in verse 22. Now somebody says, how do we find these out? This is amazing to me, and I'm going to show you this in even more profound detail. When you look at this idea right here, there were mummies. One of the things that was very interesting about a lot of these mummies, these Egyptian mummies, is when they were put in their tombs, the fluids that were used to mummify them, the fluids that were used had an incredible ability to preserve their blood vessels. So people literally would get a mummy coming out of a tomb 2,000 years later, and when they get the mummy out of the tomb and they would go ahead and investigate it, they would notice that the blood cells are absolutely still intact. Then they were able to go ahead and extract it, and they could actually find out what was in these mummies' life and what was going on with them. You can look at the University of Illinois in Chicago, and they have studies on it. You can look at Harvard, and they have studies on it. You can look at Brigham University, and they have studies on it. This is widespread now. So the reason why we're able to connect what the mummies were suffering with actual real diseases today is because of that very fact that the blood vessels can be preserved even over a millennium of time. So notice, in verse 22, there was something called the fever. Well, that's pretty easy, isn't it? We know the fever to be nothing but chills and shivering fits. And that is exactly what the Egyptians were suffering with. God says, if you keep my laws and do what I say, God says, I will not ever have you go through another fever. God literally is making promises that all we need to do is grasp it by faith and believe he will accomplish what he has promised he will accomplish. Going on, look at this. Inflammation. That was in verse 22. Now, what's amazing is these were called curses, but we're actually studying them and we're noticing these curses were in fact diseases. So when the Bible says the curse causeless shall not come, it is biblical for us to say that disease causeless shall not come. The same way no curse ever comes without a cause is the same way no disease comes without a cause. And anytime a physician, a medical practitioner says there is no cause for this disease, they forgot a very important word. You know what that word is? Known. It is not right for us to say there is no cause for a disease because that would mean that God lied. God says a curse never comes without a cause and disease never comes without a cause. But it is possible that our knowledge is limited. And therefore, the appropriate thing to say to a patient is not there is no cause for this disease. It is appropriate to say there is no known cause for this disease. We have not figured it out yet. But when there is a cause, what does God tell us to do? Search it out. Very good. Now, going on, when you think of inflammation, you think of arthritis, bronchitis, and anything that ends in ITIS. Laryngitis, all of the ITIS constantly brings us back to inflammation. Well, we also look at the botch. That was in verse 27. The botch would be things like chicken pox and hives. There was also the emrods in verse 27. All of these were curses. There was the emrods in verse 27. The emrods would be like tumors, hemorrhoids, and various cancers. Then God says, a curse is that he will smite them in the knees and in the legs. There are diseases that have that very same effect, like osteoarthritis and polio. So literally, these diseases that the Egyptians were going through are very much diseases that we can see happening in our modern 2015 societies today. And just to imagine, God says, if you do everything I say, none of them will come upon you. You know, when it came to the healing work, one day a man had a son. He was demon-possessed. And you read this story in the book of Mark, chapter 9. And when this man had a son who was demon-possessed, this man, he was asking Jesus, his disciples, please heal my boy. And they couldn't do it. So when Jesus came along, the man said, listen, you know, Jesus here, I thought your disciples could do it, but they didn't. And then Jesus says, how long has he been like this? And the man begins to explain. Jesus then says to him a very important point in Mark, the 9th chapter. And I want you to watch what he says in Mark 9. Because I will submit unto you the same question that Christ asked this father in Mark 9, or the same point that he makes here, is the same point he's making to you and I tonight if we ever have a disease that by his grace we want to overcome. Notice what the Bible says in the book of Mark. And we're going to consider the 9th chapter, and I want you to watch very carefully what the Bible says as we consider this very, very important and profound point. Notice what the Bible says as we look at Mark 9, and we're going to look at verse 21. This is when Jesus began his consultation with this father. He says in Mark 9 and verse 21, it says, and he asked the father, how long is it ago since this came unto him? And he said, of a child. Verse 22. And oft times it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Now this man is making this point of despair because his disciples already failed. So now he's saying, please, if you can do anything, please help us. Jesus gives an amazing answer. Notice his answer. He says in verse 23, Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe. How many things are possible? He says, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. You know, I just came from Northern California. We just finished doing a beautiful gospel medical missionary training out there. Precious souls came out, got trained in the Word of God, and I thought about this, and it was so beautiful. In July this year, I was in Northern California visiting some friends. And when I was there, I remember that I got a chance to go ahead and go to this church and speak the word of God. And this sister came to me and she said, Brother Levin, I want you to go visit this lady. This lady has been listening to your sermon. She really appreciates your ministry. And she would love if you would go and do an anointing on her baby. Her baby is in ICU. The baby is in ICU. The doctors have given her no hope. They said the baby is going to more than likely die within a few weeks. Maybe a few months at best. Would you please go there and do an anointing? So I said, absolutely. So we went to the hospital. And we went there and I talked with the parents. Oh, what a wonderful family, filled with faith. The doctors got to a point that they kept telling her, listen, this baby's gonna die. But they said, no, they said, you do not have the jurisdiction to say that. They said, God is the one that gives life and God is the one that takes life. And therefore, the parents would not give in to those statements. They would say, whatever God wants, we will accept, but we are not accepting your words because you have no government over that child's life. So we went inside the room, and I remember we went there. We prayed, we went inside the room, and we went inside the room. The baby's name is Baby Hugo. And I remember we went inside of the room, and we saw this beautiful little baby, not more than 1 year old. And the baby's just laying there, all the tubes inside of him. And we came there to pray with the baby. And I remember that the doctors and everyone, you know, they were not people of faith, the family said. They said that they talked with them about faith, and they felt that all of this religious stuff is foolishness. Well, I remember we came in there, and the man saw that I was coming to pray with the child, and he just kind of gets in his chair, and he just slides himself over to the other side, like, let me let the religious people go do what they do. And I remember we prayed a prayer. And I remember I asked God, I said, Father, you know, your will is perfect. And if it would be for your name's honor and glory, that you would allow this child to defy all odds and be a convincing evidence to all of these who do not believe, and I'm saying this loud enough that they can hear, that this child will be a convincing evidence to all of those who don't believe, then please spare this child's life. But if it would be in your perfect will to let this child sleep because you know the days ahead are rough, then please give the parents peace to accept your will and let your will be done. All of us and the parents said amen, and we left that room. And I remember I was contacting them, how's the baby doing? How's the baby doing? And they kept saying, listen, we got to the point we almost need to, you know, it was almost being suggested to pull the plug. Let the baby die. The baby's going to die. The parents moved the baby to another hospital, and the long story short of it is, today baby Hugo is at home. His eyes are bright. The mother sent me pictures, and I feel so bad that I just thought of telling you this just now, because I would have put the picture that she sent me right up on that screen, and I would let you tell me if that looks like a sick and dying baby. My friends, I am here to let you know, man is limited. Man is limited. And man has no government to tell you what the end result of someone else's life is going to be. God is the God of miracles, and God asks questions to each and every one of us. And that question that God asks is very simple. God says, do you believe I can do this? Because anything's possible, but only to him that believes. And so you'll find that faith becomes a massive factor for you and I. So when God says, none of these will come upon us if we do everything he says, my hope and my prayer is that you will believe what God says. But remember, it's more important not just to hear, but to do the word of God. It's amazing how when they've studied these mummies, they found all these diseases. But it's interesting. Tonight, our subject is what? Tonight, our subject is hypertension. So you know what I did? I went online. I said, you know what? I said, I wonder, are there any studies that shows that mummies actually suffered with hypertension? And lo and behold, look what I found. Ancient mummies prove heart disease is as old as we are. And notice the date right there, July 30, just last year. And here's what they found, because if you remember the video, it kept talking about arterial plaque and all these things building up, the calcification that takes place in the vessels that ultimately causes the blockages, etc. Look at this. It says a paper published earlier today in Global Heart reported that atherosclerosis is surprisingly easy to find in the remains of ancient humans from Egypt, Peru, the Aleutian Islands, North America, East Asia, and Europe. Researchers reviewed computed tomographic, of course, CT scans, of the mummies to detect calcification in the arteries. Isn't that amazing? Look at that. And then it goes on to say, the fact that it's so easy to find these calcifications, these residues and sediments in ancient people is surprising, said study co-author Dr. Randall Thompson, an associate professor of medicine at the University of Missouri School of Medicine in Kansas City and a cardiologist and researcher at the St. Luke's Mid-American Heart Institute. It was surprising to us and a lot of people. So it's amazing to know that even hypertension was one of the diseases that the mummies suffered with, the Egyptians suffered with, of which God says, if you do everything I say, it will never come back by his grace. I can keep it from you. By God's grace, God says I could even cure you from it. And so my hope and my prayer is that as we go through the remainder of our study tonight, may you and may I believe that with God, all things are possible. So let's continue. So when we go further a bit in our study, we're going to notice some other things here, and this becomes important. The first thing we want to consider is the question on heredity. Heredity, a lot of times, you know, I'm 43 years old. According to the statistics, as a 43-year-old black man, whatever my parents had, I should have by now, according to all the statistics of lifestyle and livelihood. So on my father's side, hypertension, diabetes runs rampant. On my mother's side, cancer. Cancer killed my mother. Cancer killed my aunt. Cancer killed my other aunt. So cancer runs rampant on my mother's side. Hypertension and diabetes runs rampant on my father's side. I'm 43 years old, and if the Lord spares my life, in March next year, I'll be 44. None of these diseases. Now, people often use the term, well, heredity is the issue. It's hereditary. So if your parents had it, your parents' parent had it. Well, that's not exactly what the Bible says. You see, I want you to watch this. If you look carefully at the scripture, watch what the Bible says. Some people say it's heredity. Is this true? Well, let's notice the Bible. When you look at the Bible, you remember in the second commandment, God said something. Of the Ten Commandments, it was in the second commandment, God made a statement that is true even as it relates to diseases and health. Notice. In the second commandment, here's what God said. He made a statement where he talked about, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images. Then he says, thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. Watch these words. Visiting the iniquity of the who? Fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that what? That hate me. So notice, why did the visitation of their iniquities continue all the way up to the third and fourth generation? Why did it happen? Because the one thing all the generations had in common is they all hated God. So if grandfather hated God, then grandfather taught father to hate God, and then father taught son to hate God, and son taught ultimately his son to hate God. So as a result of them all doing what the parents did, they all got what the parents had. Are you following? So this is the ideology behind this concept of heredity. If we do what our parents did, then yes, we are destined to have what our parents had. But notice the break in the cycle. The thing that these all had in common was it was to them that hate me. But then the verse says, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. So God right here broke the generational curse. God was able to break the generational curse. Why? Because the previous generations hated God, but the further generations chose to love him and to keep his commandments. And the generational curse was broken. That's the reason, my friends, why I can stand before you, 43 years old, and I don't have what my parents had, because I'm not living how my parents lived. And so we do not want to allow this thing of heredity to have an undue role. It might create a disposition, but it does not have to be a guaranteed fact you will get it. Always remember, heredity is like a gun. A gun is not dangerous until somebody picks it up. As long as a gun sits on a table, it is not dangerous. But once somebody picks it up and pulls that trigger, that's when the damage happens. This is the concept of heredity. Heredity loads the gun, but lifestyle is what pulls the trigger. So as long as you and I don't pull the trigger, we never have to worry about a bullet piercing anything. But if you and I have the same lifestyle like parents of old, then we might as well go ahead and be prepared to accept what our parents had. Does that make sense? Now watch this. Let's continue then. So when we start looking at causes, when we start looking at the causes for these things, I decided again, I said, okay, well, let me go ahead and look at it. There is something called primary, which is essential hypertension. This type of high blood pressure, called primary essential hypertension, tends to develop gradually over many years. However, if we go ahead and look at this, there's a different point here. If we look at our book, Health Power, page 40, if I were to turn there, it begins to walk you through all sorts of different reasons why individuals can develop hypertension. One of the key things we know is salt. We know that there's a lot of sodium intake. There's also obesity. There's also lack of exercise. There's also arterial plaque. And of course, there is a high sodium intake. When we start looking at these things, these are contributors as it relates to hypertension. And there's more. Smoking can bring it on. Overconsumption of alcohol, low potassium. You need potassium to help metabolize sodium. So if your body's low on potassium, it cannot properly metabolize all the sodium. And if you take too much sodium and there's not the right elements or minerals within us to help metabolize it properly, then obviously that sodium's gonna get a bit out of control. So there are many things that can contribute to hypertension, of which we're gonna build on a little bit more as we go further. But outside of primary, there is also secondary hypertension. Well, how does that work? When you look at secondary hypertension, some people have high blood pressure caused by an underlying condition. This type of high blood pressure, called secondary hypertension, tends to appear suddenly and cause higher blood pressure than does primary hypertension. Various conditions and medications can lead to secondary hypertension, including, number one, obstructive sleep apnea, kidney problems, adrenal gland tumors, thyroid problems. All of this can bring on secondary hypertension. And then also certain defects in blood vessels you're born with, congenital, certain medications such as birth control pills, cold remedies, decongestants, over-the-counter pain relievers, and some prescription drugs. They can actually elevate your blood pressure very quickly, okay? Also, illegal drugs such as cocaine and amphetamines, and then finally, alcohol abuse or chronic alcohol use. All of these things can contribute also to secondary hypertension. So there's a lot for us that we have to consider, there's a lot we have to think about, there's a lot we have to look after, and then if it's present, we have to approach it intelligently. Is it secondary? Is it primary? What's happening? But again, we know that generally when we think of hypertension, we think of high sodium intake. We think of images like this. We think about all that salt intake. But then here's the big question, and it's funny, I remember asking physicians this question as well. And I thought that there would be a quick answer, but sometimes there wasn't. And I asked the question is this. I said, what is the culprit with hypertension? They'll say high sodium intake. Then I go ahead and I say, okay, well, how much salt is too much? And then it gets quiet. And it shouldn't get quiet, because it's not fair for you. Just think about it for a minute. If I'm an ignorant layperson, if I'm just an ignorant man on the street, I don't know what's going on with me, and I'm going to the professionals who have studied for 8-10 years, got their degrees, got all the beautiful letters behind their names, etc., I'm expecting you to help me out. So when I come to you and if I say, okay, what has brought on my hypertension, doc? And then the doctor says, well, it's high sodium intake. Then obviously it's logical how high is high. Because if you don't help me know how high, I can make up my own rules. You understand that? And you don't want people to make up their own rules. That can be dangerous. And this is why you got some people who take in no sodium at all, or you have individuals that are still taking high sodium while in their minds they call it little, because they're comparing themselves to a whole bunch of their indulgent friends. So we don't want to be the ones to determine what is too much salt for ourselves. So again, I'm thankful. The professionals, they said, hey, let's go ahead, let's search it out. Let's study food. Nutrition is still a very neglected field, even with many a medical professional today. It is something that is often not part of the regular curriculum. If anything, it's an elective. And even if you take the elective, a lot of times it's just a few hours. It's not even a truly grand number or a grand majority of the training. So that's the reason why sometimes you get a lot of even quote-unquote medical professionals that do not understand nutrition. They don't understand it. And that's why sometimes when you say, doc, how much salt is too much? They don't know the answer. Or they'll say, well, the dietitian will tell you. The problem is, quick story again. I remember one time I went to visit my father, diabetic, got one foot cut off, and he's in the hospital because of his complications. The nurse comes in the room and the nurse says, Mr. Lemon, all right, it's time to eat your food. And she gave my father white rice. Well, when she gave my father the white rice, I said, nurse, come here, please, can I talk to you? You know, because it's my father, I'm not going to stay silent with my father. So when the nurse came by, I said, can I ask you something? I said, why are you giving him white rice? And she said, what do you mean? I said, white rice is not a complex carbohydrate. White rice is a simple carbohydrate. It's a simple sugar. It's going to break down faster, and it's going to cause a lot more of the insulin to be released from the pancreas, but it's not going to be able to manage that glucose, because the glucose is going to be very, very high. So as a result of that, that's going to become problematic with my father, and it's going to cause his sugar to shoot up. She says, let me get the dietitian. So I said, all right, you go get the dietitian. The dietitian comes downstairs. I come to the dietitian. I said, why are you giving my father white rice? She says, what do you mean? And I started to walk her through the same process. I said, if anything, if you're going to give my father rice, give him. And then before I could even say it, she said, brown rice. I said, exactly. I said, if you give him brown rice, I said, it will manage better between the glucose and the insulin, be able to ride together to hit the cell, kind of unlock the cell, open up the cell, take in the glucose, lock it in, and my father would be okay. She says, I know. And I said, well, if you know, why didn't you give it to him? And her pathetic answer was, he didn't ask. I wanted to call her a demon. I said, you expect him to ask you? You are supposed to know better. And that's why I want you to watch carefully a video clip I'm going to show you in just a moment. Because there is something grotesquely wrong with the United States' present medical system. There's a lot wrong with it. There's good people in it, loving people in it, people who are doing their best, and sometimes things can go right, but generally, there's a lot wrong, and there's a lot broken, and it needs to be fixed. And so we ask simple questions, how much salt is too much salt? Well, the answer is very simple. Number one, when we begin to look at it, if you look at some of these images here, notice this. In Health Power, right there on page 126, it has a section dealing with nutrition and sodium levels. For an individual that is an adult at approximately 200 pounds living a sedentary lifestyle, most times they're just sitting at a desk, et cetera, they're not walking around and doing a lot, all they need, notice, is an average of about 1 gram or 1,000 milligrams, which is 1/5 of a teaspoon of added salt in a given day. Added salt. Why? Because, my friends, all food already comes with sodium in it. They already have a natural level of sodium. The problem is most of us don't know how to prepare food. And that's why Saturday evening, right at sunset, we're going to do a nice little cooking class. You're going to get to eat some good, healthy food. And one of the things that I want you to understand is this. The beauty of it is this is how a lot of us prepare food right now. I always tell people to do this test. Get a clear glass and rest it right on the table. Then I want you to take a carrot, shred a few pieces of the carrot inside of the glass till maybe it gets just a little bit under half of the glass. Then I want you to take cold water. What kind of water? Cold. Take cold water, pour it inside of that glass with the carrot, pour it inside until it just gets just a little bit above the actual carrot itself. Then I want you to take the glass, put your hand on top of the top, put your hand at the bottom, and I want you to shake it like this. Like real hard, shake it real hard. Do it for like about 30 seconds. Real hard, just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and shake that thing. Then take another clear glass, lay it on the table, pour the water inside of it. What color do you think that water is gonna be? It's gonna have an orange hue to it. You know what that orange color represents? It represents some of the vitamins and nutrients that was in the carrot. So as a result of taking water, some strong, hard friction on it, and then pouring it into the other glass, it stripped some of the nutrients. Now here's the lesson. Get the glass out of the way, and now you have a pot. Instead of just a little bit of water, now you have a lot. And you're pouring all that water in your vegetables in the pot, and then instead of shaking it for 30 seconds, we turn a fire on under it for a lot longer than 30 seconds, which causes a friction called boiling. And when we boil our vegetables for a long period of time, drowned in all that water, then after a while, we're going to eventually say our vegetables are ready. And when the vegetables are ready, we usually take the pot and we go on a special trip. Anybody know about that special trip? Where's the trip that we go to? We go to the sink. And when we go to the sink, what do we do with all that water? We dump that water down the drain. And what do you think is going down the drain with that water? The nutrients. And we are people that like food and we like taste. So we're not going to eat a bunch of bland string beans. We're not going to eat a bunch of bland peas. So what do we have to do? We got to season it. So what do? We get the salt out and we do a whole lot more than what we should be doing. And lo and behold, retention of water causes swelling, presses against the blood vessels. The blood vessels get narrowed, and the heart now has to apply more pressure to get the blood through, and congratulations, we have high blood pressure. And so the more we learn how to prepare food to maintain its natural sodium, you actually only need to add a little extra. I decided to get my other medical book. This is my medical book called The Encyclopedia of Foods and Their Healing Power. And I started to look through some of this information. And when I started to go through my Encyclopedia of Foods, it has a whole section right here on what to increase in your diet as it relates to the disease of hypertension. And when I went to the page dealing with salt, I was amazed to find that it says right here on page, volume one, page 346, it says approximately half a teaspoon of salt a day, which is 1.25 grams, covers the need for sodium of an adult at approximately 200 pounds with a sedentary lifestyle. Amazing. So a lot of us are putting way too much salt, especially if we're consuming a lot of high processed foods, even if it's vegetarian processed food. Vegetarian or meat, you're still getting a lot of salt. You understand? And especially them ones that come out of the can. You might as well just call it a heart attack in a can. So what God wants us to understand is, hey, you got to deal intelligently with your body. Now, because we have this little bit of salt, some of us are saying, how in the world am I going to season my food then? The way you're going to season it is you don't have to use a lot of salt because you have a lot of other seasonings. You see, you can use a little bit of salt because you can use lots and lots of different seasonings that can add all sorts of beautiful, wonderful flavor. You understand that? So it is possible to comply with what our body needs in such a way that we don't have to keep having these issues with hypertension like many of us are suffering with even today. Well, let's continue. Another thing we want to think about is this. If I do have hypertension, what should I do? What should I do? What's one of the first things I should do? I know we have to ascertain the cause, but once we ascertain the cause, what do you think would be a good next step? I want to education, that's part of the ascertaining the cause. But the next thing I want to encourage you to do is start praying. A lot of people don't pray about their diseases, but there's a lot of power in prayer. In fact, even medical science is starting to discover this. There are actual different types of scientific evidence that's showing that prayer actually works. And now all these articles are coming out, and here's one of them as an example. This article right here, just this year, science proves the healing power of prayer. Studies have shown prayer can prevent people from getting sick, and when they do get sick, prayer can help them get better faster. Duke University's Harold G. Koenig, MD, states. An exhaustive analysis of more than 1,500 reputable medical studies indicates people who are more religious and pray more have better mental and physical health. And out of 125 studies that looked at the link between health and regular worship, 85 showed regular churchgoers live longer. So there's actually a benefit that comes. And if any of you study this, especially those of you who are studying A&P, I'm sure that if you're studying A&P, anatomy and physiology, you must have studied the endothelial cell or what we call endothelial function. And if you study the endothelial cell or the endothelial functions, it's noticed that the more happy and mirthful an individual is, it does something called endothelial function, which actually helps produce a chemical reaction in the body that helps strengthen the immune system, helps keep the body calm. It does wonderful things for the system, and it proves beyond any shadow of a doubt what the Bible said, a merry heart does good like a medicine. Proverbs 17:22. It amazes me how God actually says, I knew it all along. Today we have men that are getting all sorts of accolades and praise, and God says, I knew it all along. And this is why I believe we're living in a time in Earth's history where we need to give credit to whom credit is due. God says, I made these rules up. It was not all of the people who are becoming famous, making millions, producing books, and selling them to people like you and I, and we watch their videos, and we're downloading and downloading. These people are making a massive amount of wealth on what God said all along. And what's sad is they don't give God the credit. They're actually taking it themselves. That's offensive. And as God's child, I'm offended of what's being done to my father. And so I believe we need to give credit back to whom it belongs. The Bible is not just a great spiritual book, it is also the best health book that mankind could get their hands on. And so this is why we would do well to consider not simply the gospel, but the gospel of health. Now, sooner or later, we have to entertain the question, what about my medications? What about my medication? What am I going to do? I have to take medicine. Well, the truth of the matter is this. I am not here to tell anyone to not take medicine. I can't do that. I would be overstepping my boundaries. I just believe that we need to consider some things. There's one point that we need to understand. Some people take medication hoping to get healed. Other people take medication because they just want to control. In the mind of God, God does not want us to control or manage disease, because we saw in the word that to him that overcomes. God wants us to overcome disease, not just to manage it and control it for the rest of our lives by popping more and more pills, and eventually when the pills and the chemical compounds wear off and don't affect our system as strongly anymore, then we just get graduated to the next drug, and the next drug, and the next drug, and we're constantly putting in mass amounts of poison in our system, where sooner or later the body reacts very negatively. God says, I have a better plan. And so I believe that the first step is understanding whatever we take, it should be for healing and not simply for controlling, managing. But in addition to that, we must understand that anytime we approach healing without God, that we could very much be offending God. And this is why Jeremiah makes a statement that he says here. Jeremiah makes a statement. I'm going to bypass the health power quote. We can go back to that later. But it says this: for this is the day of the Lord. This is the day of the Lord God of hosts, a day of vengeance, that he may avenge him of his adversaries. And the sword shall devour, and it shall be satiate and made drunk with their blood. For the Lord God of hosts hath a sacrifice in the north country by the river Euphrates. Go up into Gilead and take balm, O virgin, the daughter of Egypt. In vain shalt thou use many medicines, for thou shalt not be cured. God was showing them, as long as you're constantly living in violation and disobedience to me, he says, even the medicines you take, you'll take it in vain, because you will not receive cure. And so it is that today it's not a surprise to me that many a times medications could be taken, our hope is for cure, but we don't see that cure. The key is, first we must put our trust in God. And then after we put our trust in God, we need to understand, Lord, what's your program for health and healing? Because we are living under a system that is grossly compromised. And that's not just me saying it. That is the medical professionals. Watch this next video clip. Look at this.
The American healthcare system is badly broken.
The present system doesn't work, and it's going to take us down. We need a whole new kind of medicine.
We're in the grip of a very big industry, and it doesn't want to stop making money.
If I spend 5 minutes with you and then put in one of these stents, I'd probably get paid $1,500. For me to spend 45 minutes with the patient to try to figure out what their true problem is, I'd probably get paid $15. It's a completely irrational system.
We don't have a healthcare system in this country. We have a disease management system.
We're spending almost twice as much in America as any other country on earth, but our lifespan isn't even in the top 20.
30,000 Medicare recipients die each year from care they didn't need.
That's the equivalent of a jumbo jet crashing every single week. If the aviation industry killed as many people, we'd be up in arms.
The administration pays you based on how many patients you see.
All right, who's next?
If you try and buck the system, someone says, what can we do to get your productivity up? I'm not interested in getting my productivity up. I'm interested in helping patients.
We're seeing the military just being a microcosm of the problems society's having.
Soldiers' use of prescription drugs has tripled in the past 5 years.
This medications I was on.
Only by accepting that the American healthcare system is badly broken will we be able to seek out the escape fires, the potential solutions. There are answers.
One company has figured out how to lower healthcare costs by more than 40%.
We provide incentives for people to engage in healthier behaviors.
The Army Surgeon General directed that we establish the Pain Management Task Force to take a look at alternatives to narcotics.
I was skeptical, so skeptical.
I've gotten a lot of inspiration, a different perspective. There's a different way of doing things that is possible.
If I think about what healthcare could be like, it would have a lot more care in it.
The healthcare system is unsustainable. We're really mortgaging the future. Not just the health of healthcare, we're talking about the health of the nation.
doing a thing that is not working and needs a tremendous reform? Or do you want to start thinking a little bit more out of the box like some of those physicians and surgeons and practitioners started doing? And do you want to start saying, you know what, how can I really help people rather than just simply show folks how to be managed? So these are the things that we all have to come face to face with and consider. So what are some of the things that's really contributed to the issues connected to hypertension? Number one, let's talk about food. I remember I started going through the list here, and I was pretty shocked, I have to admit. As I started to look here, there's an arrow that shows. What I really like about this is that there are foods that individuals have taken hours upon hours upon countless hours to study to say, what are the foods that actually impact hypertensive patients that can actually help them lower their blood pressure and get it regulated? Then they also said, what are some of the foods that are actually causing hypertension? What are some of these foods? Thank you. What are some of these foods that's actually causing hypertension? So as I started to go through this, I want you to see that you'll see the pink border here, and it goes through a large list of which I can't name them all, but I'm going to highlight some of them. In other words, what I'm about to put on the screen, if these things are part of your diet today, you are either preparing or even aggravating the hypertension you have, or preparing to receive the hypertension sooner or later in your lifestyle. Number one is coffee. Coffee intake. They actually started to study this. And again, I leave the books here that if you want to look at it, you can look at it and just say, how did they come to these conclusions? Because I cannot do it in this time frame that we have here, but the information is here. So coffee, number one. Number two, black and white pepper. A lot of these spicy foods. Sometimes we eat a lot of spicy food because of culture. Well, that's one of the things I like about Christianity. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17, it says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. And when you're a new creature, that means you entered a new culture, and that culture is called Christianity. And in Christianity, God wants us to prosper and be in health, even as our soul prospers. So if I see that the consumption of a lot of these spicy foods is having a vasoconstrictive effect upon my blood vessels, then that is a style or a type of food that I need to eliminate from my new lifestyle and new culture and my new diet. But it's not just black and white pepper, it's also cheese, especially mature cheeses. When you think of your Parmesan, when you think of your cheddar cheese and these type of things, massively contributive to hypertension. Not only that, but also your flesh foods, your meat. These things are contributive to hypertension. So if somebody says, I want to get over my hypertension, then these are the things you want to start looking very carefully at and saying, do I really need it? Is it possible I can begin scaling back and ultimately getting off so that way I can get rid of this thing out of my life so I can have perfect, faultless, overcoming health by the grace of God? Not only that, but soft drinks. This is one of the number one causes in the world of food for esophageal cancer. All these carbon-based drinks that we're putting inside of our system, it ought not be. Then also eggs, especially eggs with the yolk. These are the criminals. These are the ones that are going in our bodies and is causing the various complications that is causing us to become hypertensive. So if we really want to go ahead and make the change, this is what we need to start studying. And I thank God that today you do have a lot more physicians now that are talking about this. It may not be because of their previous general education, but there's a lot of post-education. And that's one of the things you'll see. If you watch the program Escape Fire, you'll actually see that. Tons of physicians all over America of different religious and no religious persuasion that are just tired of watching their patients die when they know there's something better than these drugs we're giving them. And what they did was they found a place, especially in Phoenix, Arizona, and they found a place where individuals can actually go and get education on nutrition and lifestyle. Well, how much more in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? In the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we are a movement of lifestyle. We are a movement that has been given a health message. And as a result of that, we have been very, very tremendously gifted, and that's why it's almost like a double rebuke when we are who we are and we are still stricken with all these various diseases. God says, how did that happen? And so what we need to do is we need to get back on board and get back on the blueprint and do what God has called us to do. So one of the first things we need to do is, if we know these things are causing and aggravating our present diseases, especially with hypertension, then these become the points of elimination. And that's why on Saturday evening, we're going to talk about how can we replace some of these food groups. How can we go ahead and still enjoy the taste of cheese, even though it may not be cheese? How can we still enjoy the taste of meat, even though it won't be meat? How can we still enjoy food? By no means are we saying that you got to eat like a rabbit for the rest of your life. That is not what we're saying. But we are making a point to say, listen, folks, we must get to a place that we got to learn it's not about living to eat. We got to eat to live. Amen? All right. Are there foods that can help reverse hypertension? Now, that's on the arrows pointing up. When it goes into the arrows that are pointing up, these are the things they're encouraging us to eat more of that will help eliminate, by the grace of God, the hypertension. Number one, lots more of what we call the natural diuretics. Rather than taking a lot of these water pills and all these other things, these are God's natural diuretics. It's your raw food, eating more raw fruits, eating more raw vegetables. They already have a good water content to it, and it helps wash out that excess sodium. Sodium decreases the swelling, blood vessels begin to dilate, and all becomes well. So our natural diuretics, your natural fruits and your fruits and your vegetables, especially again in their raw state, this is what's going to help us tremendously. But then in addition to that, legumes are especially wonderful for combating hypertension. If you have hypertension, think about the legume or the bean world. What is it that you like? What is it that your body can tolerate? Some people don't like kidney beans. Some people do. Some people don't like lentils. Some people do. Find out what works good with your system, because there is a multiplicity in that family of the legumes. But legumes combat hypertension in a beautiful way. Then, whole grains. Whole grains. You want to do your absolute best to make sure that if I'm eating a cereal, if I'm eating rice, if I'm eating bread, if I'm making pancakes, biscuits, or whatever it may be, make sure those two very special words, whole grain. Always remember, when God made the grain, He made it whole. And what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. You understand that? So eat the grain whole. Don't buy this thing enriched. Enriched, what they do is in the milling companies, what they do is they'll take a whole grain with like 24, minerals and vitamins in that grain. They will actually strip it and only put 4 back and call it enriched. That is deception. That is a lie. And I like the fact that I'm in a church that is primarily Filipino. You know why? Because there are 3 things that makes up a whole grain. You know what it's called? Endosperm, germ, and bran. Those are the 3 things that make up a whole grain. Endosperm, germ, and bran. You got to have it all together. Do you know that white rice? Are you listening to me, my Filipino brothers and sisters? White rice has been stripped from its germ and from its bran, and all you have is the endosperm. And that's it. And that's the reason why you don't want to do that, because your bran, that's your number one fiber source with your whole grain. You do not want to compromise your bran. You need the bran. So the best way to eat the grain is whole. Get the endosperm, get the germ, get the bran, get the whole package the way God made it. Whole grains. In addition to that, there's more that you can do. Exercise daily, regularly. We're going to talk about these things throughout the week. In addition to that, make sure you're getting good exposure to sunlight, of which you are privileged to have plenty of, even in California winter fall months. Then on top of that, always keep the body hydrated. Anytime you get admitted into a hospital, the first thing they do is hydrate you, because they know even their drugs won't work unless you got enough liquid inside of your system, enough fluid. So we need to keep our bodies hydrated so that all of the wonderful nutrients we put in our system will do their job faithfully. Always remember, how much water do we really need? I know that sometimes we use different things as far as the metric systems, but I'm going to use the plain language, simple one. Ounces, fluid ounces. Everybody can understand that, because every time you get a bottle of water, it's going to talk about fluid ounces. And when you get your fluid ounces, you just simply want to take your body weight, divide it in half, and then go ahead and whatever that number is, you want to consume that in a day in fluid ounces of water. So if you're 200 pounds, you go ahead and take 100 ounces of water and you spread that out throughout the day. In the morning, you might take 2 cups of water. Then later on, you might take 2 cups more. Then later on, you can spread it out. You don't have to chug it all in one shot. Just spread it out throughout the day. But you got to get your water in. And yes, it is true that coffee has water and orange juice has water. But like I said, you would not wash your clothes in orange juice, would you? So then why would you wash your body out with it? You need water to help keep your body clean. You need water to be the natural cleansing process that God made for our bodies. So you go ahead and you make sure you get good water consumption. If you do not drink enough water, the body will actually take it from the following areas: blood, bones, liver, skin, colon, and even the brain. The body needs what it needs. In one way or the other, it's going to get it until it eventually crashes. So you don't want to keep neglecting your body. Make sure you give your body the hydration that it needs. And then, of course, the cells. As far as vitamin D, many studies are finding vitamin D may lower blood pressure by altering renin. This is the enzyme that constricts blood vessels and raising blood pressure. So it helps alter the renin, increasing insulin sensitivity. Insulin resistance is a risk factor for high blood pressure. That's why typically hypertensive is always associated with diabetes. So vitamin D, you get to go ahead and do that. Reducing arterial calcification. Actual sunlight exposure and vitamin D increase helps to reduce arterial calcification. Hardening of the arteries may contribute to high blood pressure. Vitamin D regulates calcium absorption and metabolism. Higher vitamin D levels help direct calcium to the bones and teeth rather than the soft tissues such as the arteries. So you want to go ahead and do your best to make sure that you get your good sunlight. If you say how much sunlight, just remember, if you're light skin, if you're pretty much caramel complexion or above, you should get a good 30 minutes in the sunlight. If you are dark skin, again, caramel complexion and below, you're going to need a good 60 minutes of sunlight. I have more melanin in my skin. My melanin works like a filter from the rays of the sun. So I have to stay in the sun a little bit longer than someone who is lighter that has less melanin. So therefore, I got to go ahead and stay in the sun a little bit longer so I can get the same benefits that a quote-unquote light-skinned person would receive. When you go out into the sun, just remember, don't put any sunscreen on. That's going to mess it up. You do not want to put any sunscreen. That's going to block your body's ability to absorb. So you do not want to put any SPF 8 or SPF 15 or any of those type of things. And basically, the face, the neck, and the arms need to be exposed when you're getting your sunlight in. If you get the face, neck, and arms, you're in pretty good shape to get a good dose of your sunlight. There are herbal treatments. One of the best herbs/foods that you can enjoy is garlic. Garlic is your friend when you think of hypertension. In fact, I have up here, and again, if you want to look, you can just come up and look afterwards. This is the Encyclopedia of Medicinal Plants. And what they do is they have a whole section right here of all sorts of herbal treatments, from teas to infusions to presses that you can put that can help as it relates to hypertension and the various challenges that come along with it. But there's one thing that can definitely cause an individual to go and become hypertensive. In addition to food, in addition to a lot of these other things, one thing for sure that also can cause it is none other than stress. And stress is very real for us. And stress is typically the absence of faith. When we stress out over money, over time, over jobs, over family, and over a lot of the things that causes all of this perplexity in our lives, many a times it testifies that we neither believe God nor trust Him. We don't believe that He'll take care of our finances. God tries to reason with us. He says, listen, if I take care of birds, if I take care of insects, if I take care of water creatures, why do you think I won't take care of you when you are the crown work of my creation? Are we not more important than lilies? Are we not more important than ants and birds? God says, if I'm going to take care of them and make sure they never go a day without being sustained, God says, why would you doubt that I would take care of you, O ye of little faith? And so you will find that many a times we don't have faith. We don't trust God. And as a result of that, we stress. And stress will definitely contribute to hypertension. And so if there's any of us in this room tonight and you're saying, you know what? I wish that I can go ahead and take a promise from God. I want to give you this to close, and that's in Matthew, the 11th chapter. In Matthew, the 11th chapter, there's a promise that God gives here that if we would do well to consider it, I believe that it will help us even with the stresses of life. And the Bible spells it out beautifully in Matthew, the 11th chapter, and I want us to go ahead and consider Matthew 11, and we're going to look at verses 28 to 30. And this is my message to all of us if we are still battling and dealing with the stresses of day-to-day life and allowing it to overwhelm us and even compromise our faith. The Bible says in Matthew, the 11th chapter, in the 28th verse, it says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." If there's even one person in this room that says, you know what? I hear about Jesus. I know there's lots of folks talking about Jesus. But if the truth be told, I don't trust him. I have not trusted him with my life. I have not trusted him with my finances. And therefore, I have been the boss of me. I have been taking care of myself. And I'm a very stressed out man, and I'm a very stressed out woman, because living in such a day as this in Earth's history is not easy. Jesus says, "Come unto me. You who are burdened and heavy laden," Jesus says, "let me give you my rest. You need it." Sooner or later, we're going to realize that this life and this world is a lot stronger than us. And you can fight it and you can battle it all you want. But if you handle these issues on your own, sooner or later, you will realize you are fighting a losing battle. Jesus says a profound statement that he's willing to let it be proven, which is, "Without me, you can do nothing." But I'm so thankful that he didn't stop there. Because it's true in John 15:5, he says, "Without me, you can do nothing." But then he spoke through his servant, the Apostle Paul, in Philippians 4:13, and he says, "But I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." If there's anybody in this room and you're saying, look, I go to church, or maybe you don't go to church, but the bottom line is, whether you go to church or not, if you can honestly say, "I know I don't trust God. I already know I don't. I don't trust him because my life proves it. I'm a stressed out man and I'm a stressed out woman because I know that I am not willing to trust God to take care of my issues for me, and I've been trying to handle them myself, and life is beating me up something serious, and I want some rest. I want to know how to have the peace that God often promises in his word, but I know nothing of it. I want to know how to get this, and I want to know how not only to get it, I want to keep it by the grace of God." If you know that you are in that trap and in that circle, and this is not a call for everyone to stand up for, but this is a call for some of us. If you know you are in that place and you're being honest with your own heart and with God, and you're saying, "Preacher, I need you to pray for me because I don't trust God. I have not trusted God. And I'm even kind of afraid to trust him because I don't want him to fail me. But I'm willing to at least give him a shot, and I'm going to respond to this call where I'm going to come to him and I'm going to let him give me this rest he's promising. And may I be faithful." If that's you, I'm going to invite you to please stand to your feet with me. I want to pray with you. If that's even you, that you're saying, "That's me. I have not trusted him. I have not trusted." This is not for everyone to stand. Some of you, I hope, I would imagine, have learned to trust him. But there might be even one of us that says, "I haven't." God bless you. God bless you. Would there be another who says, "That's me"? God bless you, brother. That says, "Look, I haven't trusted him. I have not allowed him to give me his peace that he keeps promising me, but I want it, and even more so, I need it." Would there be another who says, "You know what? That's me. I've been coming to church. Yep. I've been putting up a front, maybe. But I'm being honest with God and with my own heart. I need help. I need help." Would there be another who says, "Yep, that's me. Just want to pray with you." It's good to know that you got people praying for you when you got some real challenges in your life. Would there be another who says, "That's me"? Just being honest with your own self. I just want to make sure I don't pass the opportunity by if you know you're in that place and you need the strength of God. Would there be another? Because this is my final call. Would there be one more who says, "Preacher, remember me. I don't have the rest. God bless you, sister. I don't have the rest that God has promised, and I need it. Would there be another? God bless you, sister. Amen. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Would there be another? For those of you who stood, I want you to know, and those who raised their hands, I just want you to know, God's promises are unequivocal. But you have to remember what we read earlier. Promises are sure when we meet the condition. If you don't meet the condition, and yet we try to claim the promise, God says that's presumption, that's not faith. And he cannot and will not give us the breakthrough that we need. And so I want you to remember the stand. I want you to remember the hand being raised tonight. You're making a covenant with God. And by the grace of God, let nothing break this covenant that you are making with him. And he will come through, and he will fulfill his promise. For the rest of us, if you're saying, preacher, I have learned to put my trust in him, and I want you to pray for me that I will continue to put my trust in him. And maybe there's some of us that need to cooperate a little bit better with some of the things we study tonight, knowing what does contribute to this disease called hypertension. And if you're saying, keep me in prayer, that I too will be faithful and do all that God says, then please stand to your feet with me as well. And it is my privilege to pray with you and to pray for you and to know that God shall bless you. Let us have a word of prayer. Our loving Father, we are so grateful. We thank you for the things you taught us tonight, and we thank you for making your words plain. Lord, I pray that you will truly help anyone who is afflicted with the disease of high blood pressure to truly see there is a way of escape. It does require for some of us, we may even call it a sacrifice because we have developed a love for many of the habits that has brought on this disease. But I'm grateful that all things are possible with God. And so, Lord, please bless my brothers and my sisters, even beyond their expectations, and do for them what they never could do for themselves as a result of them taking their glory, laying it in the dust, and letting not their will but yours be done. And I pray that those who may be stricken will be relieved and will overcome this disease. And for those of us who may not have had hypertension yet, our hearts were still clogged with self, we would not be willing to submit our lives to you and trust you. But tonight, you have performed your miraculous surgery and you've removed the sinful plaque of our hearts and you have helped us now to once again let the lifeline of your blood flow within us. Please, God, teach us to trust you. Help us to never lose faith. Help us to remember the covenant that we have made with you tonight. And I pray may we be faithful even unto death, for it is then and only then we shall receive our crowns of life. Thank you for hearing our prayer. Thank you for your many blessings. Keep us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.